Good morning, everybody. You are tuned to Computers 2K Now on the Nissan Communications Network. I'm Amnon, your host for the next few hours, along with Steve.
Hello, everybody.
Hello. And Spence is here.
Hello.
And Mike is here.
Yep.
And our number is 919-518-9773, Computers 2K Voice on Skype. And this morning's show is being brought to you by Atomos.com, makers of quality video recorders and converters for professionals. And the broadcast is also made possible by Stellastream's Wirecast software. So what's going on?
I'm trying to download a program called HFS for HTTPFileServer.exe. It does not have a virus in it. Mm-hmm. Microsoft Security Essentials will not let me download it. I added it to the exceptions in MSE and apparently is ignoring the exception.
I think there's something about downloading an EXE.
No, it's something about downloading a file that has an HTTP server built into it.
I've used the program in the past. It was very good back the version I used, which was about 2-3 years ago.
I think it's the same one.
Could it possibly be?
Mike?
Could it be that Microsoft just doesn't like the idea that you're doing it? It has nothing to do with a threat?
Well, Mike.
Possible.
Amnon, your audio is low back to us.
And we never heard the theme song.
No.
Okay, now that was weird because I saw that the theme song was going really low on the meter here, and I said, what in the world is going on? Why is it low? But nobody. So am I still coming across low?
Yes.
Yes, but only to the Hangout.
Well, Mike, you know me.
I do know you.
What am I looking at? Everything.
Alan says he heard part of the theme song.
I'll be damned.
You're about 2/3 volume that you normally are.
Interesting. I'm trying to see here. There's nothing. Nothing is different as far as I can tell.
Did it by itself.
Yeah, you know how those knobs turn on. The thing is that when I started talking, I mean, the meter is going like crazy. I mean,
then that's not the problem.
So I understand. Is this louder?
Well, you don't crank it up to the stream. Crank it up to the Hangout.
I'm okay. Let's go over here. Okay,
is this louder? You haven't changed the volume to the Hangout.
Is this louder?
Nope.
No. Go ahead and just say something.
Hello.
Okay.
Us talking has nothing to do with your volume back to us.
I see the problem, and what am I supposed to do? The Hangout. I know what it is.
Okay. Well, then
is this better now?
No.
It is the wrong. It's the wrong
to hear your voice as long as it's coming okay through to the stream.
It's the wrong source because when I lower the Hangout fader, it's not changing anything.
I know the Hangout fader has to do with how you hear us, not how we hear you.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't, when I lower it, I don't hear you. That's what I say. Say something. And when you're talking and I lower it all the way down, I still hear you. So that means. Okay.
Then you've got the wrong driver selected in.
Yeah, that's
the Hangout.
And let's see. Let's do this. And it is for the lexicon. For the Google Hangout. That's, oh, okay. Let's do.
Did you reset the lexicon?
Realtek.
That's better.
No, the lexicon is not for that. That's the thing. I keep messing up. Realtek and Realtek and save. Okay.
It's better now.
How's this?
That's better.
Okay. I need to look at the paper. I did it from my head and.
No, my gosh, don't do that.
Yeah, now it's making a difference. Okay, yeah. Okay, fine.
It's like you're in the room with me.
So let's rewind and say hello, everybody.
I can actually hear you.
And let me adjust it again. So I mean, am I still okay now?
Yep.
Okay, so it's back where it was. That's good. All right.
So I just went through Security Essentials, went through the detected.
Mike, it's simple. Pause your real-time scanning. Go to Open Security Essentials, click on the.
On.
Yeah.
I was going to tell you a better solution than that.
Okay.
I went in, I opened to Open Security Essentials, went into the history, clicked on all detected items. It showed the file that had been whacked. I clicked on it and said, allow item, downloaded it again, and all is well.
How come the first time you tried to allow it didn't work? You tried to add it to the list?
Yes.
Yeah.
Maybe. Which I don't know why that didn't work, but.
It could be that what is identified as the text name and what the system, what the, scanner picks up are two different things.
Couldn't tell you, but by allowing the full path to it that Security Essentials detected, it allowed me to download it. Now it's probably a virus. So if I disappear, you know why.
Nah.
Well, I've probably still got a copy of mine somewhere. So if you need it, I can send it to you. Mine doesn't have a virus.
No, have you guys used a site called... Oh, now I'm going to forget the name of it. Virus Total?
No.
No.
If you go to Virus, I think that's the name of it. Let me look and see, because this is interesting. Yes, virustotal.com. You can either upload a file on your computer, or there is a button for URL. You can put the download link for a file in there. It will actually go out, download the file, scan it, give you a report on what all has determined it, which various programs have determined it to be a virus or not be a virus. So I put the download link in there, and 3 of 62 said that it was a virus, and of course the respectable ones did not.
It sounds like a useful site.
Virustotal.com.
Well, you can also download it and just right-click and say, scan with this, and scan with that.
Not if the software that you downloaded it won't.
I'd rather analyze it before I download it. Thank you.
And if it's giving you a false positive, it's if you download it, it's still going to give you a false positive. Yeah. The program's highly rated. The reason what this is all about is that it was Sean or somebody posted that Skype has now changed their system. They're only allowing you to do file transfers of 100 megabytes or less. Of course, people are all whacked off about it, but the fact is that the Skype file transfers are so slow anyway. I don't know why anybody would use it for a file that large. But this was suggested as one alternative by a commenter.
I'd rate it
10. Say again?
I would rate it 10.
Oh, I've used it
extensively.
Well, let me ask you a question. Don, does the site have malware? Not according to the tests that I've done. I have its own Regetto, R-E-J-E-T-T-O, Regetto.com/HFS. Why don't I put that in chat? I haven't recommended it yet. Steve has, because I haven't used it. But there's one other thing that they do that I like, and that is it's a portable file. There's no installation. One thing I don't like about it is it appears to be written in Java.
I found it to be very flexible, and back in the day, it was indispensable, shall we say.
Well, let me ask this. If I'm going to use it to send you a file, where is that file stored? On my hard drive?
It's stored in your hard drive under HTTP folder, and then you've got incoming and outgoing.
Yeah, you just set it up. Folders. You set it up in your... the root folder for this website?
Yeah, root HTTP. In and out.
But you have to set up a representation to it on the page and just to click on.
Yeah. There are too many options here. I don't want all these options.
There's always there's always the U.S. mail.
All it needs is a link from you with your IP number to replace, you know, the HTTP server, blah blah, whatever it's called.
Oh my gosh, look at all this.
It's very flexible.
I used to do a lot of corporate training, and I'd hold classes, and then at the end of the class, I used to make CDs. I said, this is getting old. I would like to not have to burn 20 CDs every time I have a class. So I started setting up web pages, and I hosted them on Amnon's site, and I would just build a new website for every class and just have all the files sitting on a server somewhere, and I'd create new WYSIWYG links, and it worked really good for a while. It was very simple.
I used to use it with TalkShoe after the training.
Not pretty, but it worked good. I haven't done that stuff in so long. Hey, Mike, maybe you can deliver it by Amazon same day.
Deliver what?
The file.
Oh, that's true.
Just set up a deal with them. They'll come to the house, pick it up, and deliver it.
Does this program require port forwarding? It probably no, since it's on port 80.
Port 80 is the standard.
Actually, it says port 8080.
You can change ports if you want to.
Yeah, the 8080 is safer than that's like what my cameras work, and if I want to set up something to get in, then it's 8080.
All right, so if I click on upload, how to add a folder, choose a real folder. You should now see a red folder in your virtual file system. Right click, upload. Add a folder. Where do I add a folder?
Make sure it's red and not pink.
Okay.
Port 8080, it says, is a adjunct to port 80 on a web server. It's typically used for proxy and caching.
Where the heck is add a folder?
Maybe add you have to create files, it outside the program.
New empty folder. Here we go. New folder. This would be called Amnon. Lack of anything better. All right. So then we want to.
You've got your own special folder, Amnon.
Yeah.
Don't you feel honored? Whoopee!
Honored. But the problem is I don't know where it is now.
It's under HTTP.
HTTP. I'm going to have to do. Anyway, you guys, I'll play with this. You guys go do something interesting.
Talking about Amazon. So I think it was Tuesday. I ordered 2 4 C battery holders, like for to make 6 volts, but for C batteries. So they, sure enough, Thursday, got them. And I didn't think twice about it. I put the first battery in there. It was kind of loose, but it held. And then the next one would not touch. And I said, what's going on? So I said, this is for D.
Oh.
So sure enough, inside it says D size. So I packed it back and went through the Amazon return and said, I want a refund, and finished and went ahead and ordered another one. It came the next day. But it is D. So at this point, I said, okay, I'm not going to just keep going doing this. So I called them. And she said, yeah, so you already sent one. I said, yeah, it was a D2. Something is mislabeled probably on your network, on your on the floor, in the bin. It is the wrong part number. I'm looking for C, and if somebody would look inside, they'll see it says D. She said, okay, so don't order another one and wait until you get the email from us. I said, please do it quick because I really need those things. She said, you're going to get an email. This was yesterday. Didn't get the email yet, but shipping one way and then shipping it the other way probably already is more than what the item is worth. And I'm saying, how do these guys make it?
They're not making it. I mean, they haven't made a profit yet, have they?
They lose a dollar in every transaction, but they make it up in volume.
There you go.
So that was real interesting.
Well, look at what they're doing with the same day and next day delivery, how they're offering it free initially. Well, so they got to be losing money on that. I mean, there's just no way. It costs $25 an hour for the local courier driver that they've hired to drop the stuff off here. So if you order a $24 item.
Yeah, but the thing is, it's not $25 a delivery. It's 25.
No, it's an hour.
Yeah, so they can deliver. Yeah, they can deliver still a whole bunch.
How much stuff can you deliver in an hour?
I don't know. And I don't know how many people order stuff.
Meticulously planned route that has, it's all optimized, supposedly, the way they do their courier, but who knows? So.
No. Friday, let's switch a little bit. Friday, there was a Sean from Blab showed up in a Blab talking about, and Mike, by the way, we are on Blab.
Okay.
Showed up and was talking about the fact that a lot of people were saying that Blab is going away. So he said, no, we're not going away. But he did say that they are going in a different direction. They're going for younger audience, and they want people to just hang out, not to have shows. But in a way, he said, that the shows are, we appreciate them, and we want good shows in there and so forth. I noticed that suddenly, I haven't been doing the 24/7 in a long time on Blab. So I went in, and there is the Nissan Communications icon there. It says pre-recorded and live shows, and started 2 months ago. And I went in. Sure enough, it's doing the 24/7 in 16:9 and all that. I'm saying, they just turned it back on. And the last notice on the chat was that it timed out because there was no host in there. And that's what they did back then. You couldn't just run it without having the host in the Blab.
I think it was Friday. I had a look at Blab and saw that C2K was a pre-recorded one that was playing back. I think it was Friday.
Really?
Lunchtime, my time.
I guess I didn't pay attention.
Somebody had typed in the chat interface that it timed out, and then
no, that's an
other people had come in.
That's an automatic thing. That's the the bot that goes in there and stops it, supposed to stop it if it is like just running 24/7, because they did not want that. The weird thing is, I went in, I couldn't shut it down.
All right. Weird.
Today, I think I can if I want to, because it allowed me to change the topic. So I'll bet if I try to shut it down, it will shut down. But it's just strange how out of nowhere suddenly it showed up.
But here's the problem with Blab. They have, and we've got some people listening there now who will probably disagree with me. And by the way, guys, we have an open seat. If you're in Blab, you want to participate on the show, click the call-in button. You're welcome to join us. This is not just us streaming into Blab. This is a Blab show. We're ready to have you participate. Now, it's going to look funny because we're running it through a different system, but you're welcome to participate. Anyway, actually, I don't know if that's true. Maybe what I said is not true, because you're sending YouTube live through that, and it would be like a 30-second delay.
It's about 10 to 15 now.
So I don't know how that would work. That won't work. So there's no point in having an open seat.
They can call the phone number.
Yeah, like that works. So anyway, the point being is that, in my opinion, and that's all it is my opinion, it's not worth what it costs you. They're making a serious error in that they're pissing off their base. A lot of people who have been diehard advocates of the forum, which has a lot going right about it, it's very interesting. That there's a lot good about it, but they're pissing off the people who really like it because of their incompetence. And I don't know that that's going to change. I don't know that it will. That, you know, it's one of these things that it's like these companies when they announce, oh no, all of these rumors of our early demise are premature. It's not, we're doing great. Things are going great. Next week they're gone.
Yeah. Well, he was, did you listen to the,
no.
He was saying that they are going after the younger generation that just hangs out and random discussions, not anything structured.
In other words, the low expectation crowd.
Webcam mic users.
Just want people to talk about zits and donuts.
There you go. And drugs.
So, yeah, so a couple of weeks ago, I did register a new domain called bedcasting.com, because a lot of them are doing it from bed. They're just laying there and covered. Most of them are covered up, and the only light on their face is the one from their phone, and they talk. And I guess that's what Blab is after for some reason. I don't know.
Blab would have been great back when John and Yoko were hanging out in bed. Remember that? They could have broadcast that live from, that would have been something. So they were way ahead of everything there.
But it, I mean, it's
40 years.
It's fine. I mean, we use it just to give the community on Blab another option. And that's fine, as long as we don't rely on it. And we'll see. 919-518-9773, Computers 2K Voice on Skype. So what else has been happening?
Well, Google made an announcement about their new two new clients, messaging clients. They've got Duo and Allo.
Yeah.
Did you read about this?
Yeah. So the only thing I read. The
first reaction I saw was people were just saying, what, why, more?
The only reaction I've seen is people said, do not use Allo.
Yeah.
Because it can, I mean, they actually read each message.
Well, hey, it's the Facebook model, right? Oh. We don't scan. We don't do anything to that.
No.
We don't attack conservatives unless we do.
Yeah. What happened with that? Did anybody...
Had this big meeting,
right?
And the people who didn't go to the meeting are accusing the ones who did go to the meeting that they were sucking up to Zuckerberg,
yeah.
who's whose first statement was, "Oh, I checked it. There doesn't seem to be anything happening." And then the same day, there was a woman who was blocked on Facebook because she implied that it looks like this other conservative may have been blocked on Facebook. That's all she said. And then she got the classic screen, "You have been blocked for 30 days, blah, 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 infraction, yellow card, whatever." And people accused her of making it up. She had a video of it happening as it happened on her Facebook account. So what they say they're doing and what they are doing are two different things, because a human has to look at this stuff to do this. It's not an algorithm.
You're talking about what? The attack of Facebook?
Well, Facebook has been accused of blocking conservative comments.
Oh, it's a fact, because I know a guy who runs a conservative website, very, very web savvy, and he has documented it.
Oh, I no doubt.
Yeah, but would people expect Zuckerberg to say that, yeah, it's true?
You agree to the terms of service. He can do whatever he wants.
Do whatever he wants.
But the point is that the classic defense is to deny, and the reality is it's going to go the same way as so many other programs have gone. Yes, it's popular now, but it's already losing steam. They're not growing the way they were. Their Twitter's way ahead. I mean, Twitter's already been.
They do the same
shrinking.
Thing.
Yeah, same thing. But and they wonder why. I mean, this is, call it the target syndrome.
Well,
they don't realize, they under anticipate what's the reaction's going to be. And when it happens, they're shocked. It's like, you know what? You're driving social engineering here, and you're not prepared for the consequences when people don't go along with it.
The problem is that if you liberals don't like us saying this, that's fine. Just get over it. But liberals do not want conservatives to have the right to even speak. I mean, all this tolerance, don't you remember back in the 80s and 90s, the liberals hoisted themselves out in front of the public as being the tolerant, understanding crowd. They would not, I'm conservative, and they would prefer that I not even have a right to speak.
Sure.
You see it happening in the global warming movement. Those people should be shut down. They shouldn't have even the right to say anything, because their opinion differs from ours. So it's...
And Andrew says what he says, at least in this case, is right. He says that they do promote conservative trending topics when they're negative.
Yeah. Well,
so I mean, we have to listen to this liberal tripe all the time. What if we start demanding that people take it down? I mean, that shuts down ABC, CBS, NBC, CNN, most of Fox, News and Observer, New York Times, Charlotte Observer. I mean, we don't have enough time to shut all that stuff down.
The funny thing is, though, it's that the typical person who leans conservative just doesn't have that kind. Our reaction is, you see something you don't like, you don't look. You see something you don't want to hear, you don't listen. But the opposing side, the reaction is, shut it down. I don't want anybody to hear it. I don't, even if it's said in a room with nobody in it, they can't say it.
Well, the danger is that we're getting away from the idea of free political speech. Now, in Facebook's defense and Twitter's defense, you're right. They're private companies. They are not affected by free speech requirements. They are not obligated to provide a free speech forum. So I'm not talking about what they're doing. As a business matter, it seems to me that they're making a mistake, because Facebook now, I mean, since I learned this past week, I log in, and if I'm logged in Facebook more than 5 minutes, it's unusual, because I'm only looking to see if someone I have followed who sent me something, and even I have a good buddy who uses Facebook all the time. Whenever he sends me something through Facebook, I tell him, I said, don't send it through Facebook. I don't check it that often. If it's important, you better send me an email. And
hey, Andrew, hello. Here.
Hey, I only have a couple minutes. I'm on baby duty. Just had a girl's night in the city.
You're on duty duty?
I'm on duty duty. But when, you know, I had this discussion with someone the other day, within the business, and they were telling me that this is 100% accurate, that but the The problem is when the conservative websites and the conservative talk show hosts and talking heads are screaming that Facebook is blocking and hiding. That's not true. That's not accurate. What they're doing is they're suppressing it by not allowing it to be a trending topic. So if you have 10 pieces that are trending right now on Facebook, they will take one of the 6 conservative posts and promote that, and the rest they won't. The rest will all be left-leaning pieces because they assume that majority of their user base is leaning to the left. And Twitter does the same thing with hashtags. They suppress hashtags. If they feel it's going to be controversial in the sense that it's not going to fit the values of their user base, they will suppress that post. Unfortunately, conservative values are not the majority, according to them, a majority of their user base, which is absolutely false. I think it's a 50-50 split. There are as many conservatives as liberals out there. It's a fascinating thing, but almost every single website in this caliber does it.
Andrew, it's funny that I find myself not saying this to defend them, but from their perspective, they think they're mainstream and they think they're middle of the road.
Well,
that's part of the problem.
But they also believe that, and this is something that's happened over the last 20, 30 years, where left-leaning values are 100% accurate values, 100% accurate values. Right-leaning values are bad, and you should not think that way, and you should be embarrassed to think that way. If you look on all these websites, when they write these pieces, which I'm not a – I go to left-leaning sites and I go to right-leaning sites because I want to see how both stories are being delivered. It's rare to find a site that's 100% down the middle. People can't just be unbiased in that sense. But the left side is, and you said this, Spencer, the left side honestly believes that what they are doing is 100% accurate. And all other values should be suppressed, and it's wrong, and you shouldn't even have it on television, and how dare you think this way. It's that whole thing, when something is on TV and somebody says something, everybody gets all up in arms, and they start writing letters, and they want it taken off the air because it just didn't fit their values. People, if you don't like something, turn it off.
Vote with your feet and vote with your wallet.
Yeah.
Right? Don't go or don't buy. That's what's happening to Target now. They're still in denial. Their stock price has dropped over 20% since the bathroom incident started, and they're doubling down. And they don't realize that
If you think Facebook is not screwing with posting, just look at that link that I just posted in chat, because what happened was this guy that knows his stuff posted that for a while I thought some monkey business was going on. Strange things were happening at our Facebook page. We were being blocked from posting new items. Bizarre pictures we didn't select were being paired with our posts. Recently, readers have told us they're suddenly limited as to where they can share our material. Now comes the word that Facebook has been censoring conservative-leaning news on their news feed. Anti-amnesty activists are complaining that their information is being screwed with in Facebook world. Now comes the word from the Media Research Center that Facebook has been cracking down on conservative individuals. Facebook is a private company. They can do what they want, but they portray themselves as a purveyor of free speech and openness, much like the shameful and deceitful drive-by media do. So, I mean, It's happening. You can say it's not happening, but it's happening. And if you want to look at where the source of that information is, then go in and click on that. There are other things that are going on too. And one is, for example, anytime you post anything conservative, the liberals go in there and report your post to Facebook.
Well, I'll give you something even scarier than all of this, right? So everybody has Facebook installed on their phone, except for Amnon, probably.
I don't.
Well, you don't want – I had a joke there, Mike, but Mike would get upset. Majority of people have Facebook installed on their phones, and they are not aware that Facebook is actually listening to you all the time. And this is not a crazy, you know, conspiracy theory. I'm going to give you a perfect example of Facebook listening to you. I was with Spencer in California, and we had a discussion about bone broth. Okay? A very specific thing. It's not, we're not talking about computers. We said bone broth. What do you know? Within a couple hours, he's on Facebook, and there is a ad on his Facebook stream for bone broth. That is scary.
That is scary.
That it is listening to you and basing their ads on what you are saying. And there's no denying that they are listening it if that's the case. So if you don't want that to happen, turn off the mic for Facebook.
Interesting.
No. Nobody cares. I mean, remember, if you're not doing anything illegal, you don't have anything to worry about.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you know what though, Mike? I'll tell you something. If I'm having a conversation with you about how I'm cheating on my wife, next thing I know, I have a family attorney ad on Facebook. That's a problem.
Well, look at how much time it saved you, Andrew.
It did save me a lot of time.
Oh my.
No, I mean, it goes back to look. If vote with your feet. It's been the way life has worked ever since forever. If you don't like it, just vote with your feet. And on Facebook, am I going to stop using them and boycott them today? No. But I now know who they are, and I will now treat them as the company that I know them to be, which means that I will never respond to any advertising on Facebook. In fact, I don't even look at it. And I will go in and log in, and I've got probably about 10 friends on Facebook that are the quite famous people. And because I've been friends with them for a long time, I'm one of the people they will respond to. So I like that. I mean, I like that aspect of it, and I'm not going to get rid of it. In fact, they're probably wacko leftist extremists as well, and that's fine. We're not talking politics. But I will use Facebook for the very little bit that I use it, and so be it. That's not a problem.
I would say just use them. Yeah. Use them. You can make it work for you. And here's Andrew. That's a good reason why maybe I don't have. I'm glad I don't have Facebook on my phone.
I was shocked when I saw that. No. I was shocked. I said, "Well, did you search for this?" He goes, "No, I just thought of it. Like the first time I mentioned it or thought of it was the first time that we started talking about it." And about 15, 20 minutes later, he had an ad. He's scrolling down. There's a bone broth ad.
Interesting.
It's crazy. All right, that's all I wanted to say. I have to go now.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Talk to you.
Goodbye. It just, whatever, isn't it? It's just a case of if you don't want something known, you don't open your mouth about it. Don't talk about it.
Well, that's a good point.
Leave your phone in the other room.
So can't put it. You can put a piece of tape over the camera, but how do you put a piece of tape over the microphone on your phone?
You've got to poke a pin into it several times. That stops it working forever. Sorry, no, that's not a good idea. Don't do that, people.
Farce book.
Fake book, farce book.
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that from my perspective, Facebook is a useful tool, especially for family and friends to keep in touch. And to, if you, it was especially good when we went to Alaska that first year, people said, well, put stuff on Facebook for us. We want to see what you're doing. So we kept up with that and actually created a group just for that. Mm-hmm. And by the end of the by the end, when we came back, we had over 100 people in the group, and I never invited anybody. I left it open so that people could add other people. And it was just a really great way to
communicate.
Unofficially, just say, here's what we're doing. And everybody afterwards, not everybody, but most people said, yeah, that was really good the way. And I said, look, I didn't want to be in anybody's face. And I'm sorry, I didn't mean to use that term, but it was fun. And then other people do it, and it's fun when they go on a trip, and here's some pictures from my trip, and you can comment. You don't have to even look at them, but they're there if you want to look at it.
Mm-hmm.
It's nice because it's not, but it's the controlled stuff that I just don't like. What's trending?
I think what you're saying is right for family in a close group of family and friends to just keep in contact with. But, you know, if everything's being monitored and adjusted and fiddled with, no, then it's just not a good thing.
So go ahead.
The only reason that I still carry on with it is because it notifies me when somebody has a birthday. If I don't go and post on it,
mm-hmm.
I'm not interested.
I have a question. Some time ago, I may remember it wrong, but it seems like I remember reading that Warren Buffett gave all his money somewhere.
He gave a portion of it. He didn't give it all.
No.
But it was attached. Essentially, it was a big tax dodge.
Right. But, I mean, I thought he gave it all because he said you don't need money or something like that with his secretary.
Oh,
or...
when you have most of it, then, you know, it's easy to say you don't need money.
Okay. So this week I saw a story that Warren Buffett bought $1 billion with a B dollars worth of Apple stock. And I'm saying, so now where did he get all this money? I thought he gave it all away.
No. They don't give it away.
I wouldn't have been surprised if he'd sold 1 billion of Apple stock, because Apple shares are plummeting, aren't they?
Well, are they recovering?
The article was saying that maybe he knows something that a lot of people don't know, and maybe he figures that this is the bottom, and that's why he's buying it now.
That's what he lives by. Buy low, sell high.
Yeah. $1 billion.
A billion's worth is going to push the share price up and make everybody want to buy into it because a billionaire's done that.
And then he'll sell it,
yeah.
He's not a good person from what I've heard.
I read this week that Chromebooks are out selling Apple Macs.
The Macs. Katie and Donna came by last night, and Katie had a case in her hand. She said, I'm going to look what I got. She got a Lenovo Chromebook. Really nice. And I said, okay, what doesn't it do that you want it to do? She said, it does everything I want it to do. I want to get on the internet with it. And I want something that I can watch my shows on my TV. And it does both these things great. I said, so what doesn't it do? She said, well, I can't do Photoshop on it, but I don't care about that. I have the computer to do Photoshop, but this is great. And it was like $100 and some. Lenovo. Which is nice. Real thin. Regular laptop looked like.
You say it's a laptop or a tablet?
No, it's a laptop.
Okay. Yeah, for basic web connection,
yeah.
Why not? For that kind of price, we daft not to.
And Charles is talking about the Play Store coming to Chrome OS and Android apps. Charles, call in. Because I thought that Android apps will not work on Chromebooks.
They're working on that at the moment. I read in an article somewhere that they're working to get Android working on the Chromebooks.
Oh, so they're working on it. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I still can't figure out how to upload a file to HFS.
You just put it in the folder. No,
I can't
a second.
Find the folder. I did a search on it. It's not there.
I'm trying to remember what they call it. Upload and download, I think the folders are called, aren't they?
It's got one here. It says upload. How to. Delete partial uploads, rename partial uploads, number files on upload interest instead of overriding.
Oh, you just put the file in the upload folder or in the file in the download folder, and then it makes it available to the people that are logging in. You just move it or copy it into the folder, and then it's available.
Oh, it's a virtual folder.
Yeah.
Oh.
I'm trying to remember back sort of 3-4 years ago when I was using it, and it's
okay. This I get it. What you do is created a virtual folder. It's not on the hard drive. So what I do then is this is a little geeky, but you go in and you right click on that folder and add files.
Yeah. That sounds right. Yeah.
All right. So click on here, add files, and I'll put hfs.exe in there. Then I go back to that file and do copy URL address. And I just pasted it. No, I can't paste it. Now, why? See, it shows my local IP address on my computer, not through. See, if I post that, you won't be able to get it.
No, you've got to change the part of the address to your IP address. If you've got a fixed IP, then that's no problem. But if you haven't got a fixed IP, then you've got to get your IP address every time you send a link.
Browse it. Set user password. No, don't want to do that.
If you have a fixed IP, you can go into the settings and actually put that in there so that it comes up in the link all the time.
You can choose dynamic DNS to do that too?
That's what I used to use, dynamic DNS. But if you've got a dynamic IP, then it's a pain in the butt. But if you've got a fixed IP, easy.
Right, John, it is a peer-to-peer file transfer, but somehow it's got to pick up my external IP address.
If you want somebody to come and get it from outside.
Yeah. So, I mean, what good does it do in your local LAN?
Yeah, that's interesting that they did not tell you right off the bat to get about the IP, the static and dynamic.
I'm sure it's me. I'm sure I'm the problem, but I'm trying to figure out a way around it. Menu, self-test, other options.
Do you have a fixed IP or is it dynamic?
It is dynamic, but it hasn't changed since
I've had it. It takes forever to change, so
it's good. You'd be all right. You can actually set it in the settings to give it the fixed IP address, and then it's always available to whatever. Or if you've got dynamic, then... I used to use DIN DNS.
Yeah, that's what I use.
Go ahead and put the IP address. Treat it as static.
Start, exit. Start, minimize, virtual file system. No, you guys go ahead. I'll figure it out.
Eventually. So Twitter will stop counting photos and links as part of its 140 character limit for tweets.
Oh, good.
In as soon as 2 weeks.
I thought they'd already done that.
According to a source familiar with the matter. Right now, links take up 23 characters, even after Twitter automatically shortens them. In January, the chief executive officer, Jack Dorsey, said the company was looking for new ways to display text on Twitter, and would experiment based on how people use the service. The company considered raising the limit of characters to as many as 10,000. The reason it abides by the 140 character limit is because it allows for tweets to be sent within a mobile text message, which was a common form of sending tweets back in 2006 when the site debuted.
The best reason for keeping it the size it is to keep people's comments short and sweet. Otherwise, they'll go into what people were doing to get around it was they'd take they'd type up something and they'd make it into an image and then attach the image to the tweet. So then you got beyond the character amount.
Yeah, and before you know it, there will be dynamic website. On those tweets, a whole, you know, you can build a whole website in there. I'm glad that it's small.
It makes sense to keep it small because you can read it easily and quickly on a small screen without having to scroll.
Yes, It does. If you go to the Nissan Communications page, hopefully Nathan will take care of it. I don't know. I mean, I tried to clean it a few times. It scrolls so fast that you can't really keep up with what's going on. And those are not tweets that have anything to do with Nissan Communications. They're like retweets and people that were added. I don't know. It's not practical. Let's put it this way. The computer Stuke now is better. It's just like when you're in an event, a video event, and it has a chat, and there are 10,000 people in it. I mean, the chat is worthless. It's like the way that they're playing credits at the end of show on TV these days. It's just, and it's gone. So I don't know. It's good that it's short anyway. Researchers at Kaspersky discovered an improved version of backdoor Win32 skimmer, the things that they put in ATM machines, infecting ATM machines worldwide. The new skimmer allows criminal access to card data, including PIN numbers, as well as to actual cash located in the machine. The malicious... Again?
Wow. Weird.
Yeah. The malicious installers use the Packer Thermida to disguise the skimmer malware, which is then installed on the ATM. If the ATM file system is FAT32, the malware drops the file netmgr.dll in the folder, blah, blah, blah. And if it's a NTFS file, it places it somewhere else in the data stream, which makes detection and analysis of the malware more difficult. So here is me again. Everybody uses ATMs. Do you know I never had a chance to use one? I never needed to use one.
Well, you got so much money.
Yeah, right. It's just that, I mean, I'd rather go into the bank and talk face to face with the teller if I need something like that.
Well, pretty soon they're going to be replaced with kiosks because they don't pay $15 an hour.
Yeah, true. So then I would have a problem. Then I would have to buy a California king-size mattress. Right, Mike? Nah, single. I mean, a twin will be big enough. But it's a problem. And I don't understand. In banks, why can't there be this is something that they insert into the slot that you don't see. Why can't there be some type of a sensor to see that there is some another piece of hardware is now being
Coastal Credit.
I mean, there's got to be a way to do this.
Coastal Credit Union has traditional ATMs, which I don't use anymore, but they have the remote tellers where you walk up to the teller station, but you show your ID. You don't use your card. You put your license down there, and that's how I identify you. So
yeah, but I'm talking about the ATM machines.
No, I understand. What I'm saying is there is an alternative, which I didn't think that the remote teller thing was such a good idea at first, but now that it's been out there and I'm used to using it and I have had zero issues with it. In the beginning, there was a problem. If you tried to make a cash deposit, it had to read the money in. And if it didn't If there was a mistake, they'd have to try to send somebody out to get into the machine. It was very confusing, but it hasn't been an issue. And I cash most of my checks using my phone app now. I don't even have to go there. But when I do go there, it's always been very easy. And I think it's pretty secure. They have some inside the lobby.
You mean
locked when the bank is closed. They have some in the foyer, or whatever they want to call it, that you can access. If you have a card, you can access to get into the where the machines are. The machines are not outside. They're not open access. But they do have extended teller hours beyond the regular banking hours, which is good. They have weekend hours.
You mean you have a phone that spits out cash?
It prints it right there. The money's still wet when it comes out.
John says that the skimmer is external. I understand that. And that's also something that that one way that you can tell is, you know, normally when you put your card in, how far in it goes. And they say that if you see that suddenly that it's actually went farther, or seems to be, because less of it is sticking out, then you may be on a skim. And it also looks different because it is external. It's hanging there. But if you never go to the ATM and you're not used to it, you don't know that, hey, that piece is not supposed to be there.
It's like, don't buy gas at a gas station with your debit card, because that's another popular place.
That's another thing. And that's what I was going to say as far as banks is, why can't they have a routine that every morning somebody who understands these things go and checks their ATM outside?
I think the ones that are most susceptible are going to be ATMs in, you know, the ones that you find in a convenience store.
Fine.
In a lobby of a hotel or someplace that's not a bank.
But that's fine. So have somebody. Somebody needs to check these. I mean, somebody checks them anyway, because they come, they put money in it, and they take money out and all that. Somebody needs to check it, but I don't know how often they check it.
It used to be that being active skimmers was, it required several bits. It wasn't just putting the skimmer on there. You had to be, the person stealing the information had to be close by. They had to be within radio contact of the skimmer. They had to have a camera hidden, usually in a brochure bracket, so they could see the person enter the PIN number, or be able to see the person entering the PIN number with binoculars. But the new ones that actually capture all this stuff, that's where it becomes really dangerous.
Yeah.
And they don't have to be local. You can record it. Microprocessor technology has gotten so good, you can have everything to read the skim in.
And that means that it stays there for a longer period of time. They don't put it there and 2 hours later somebody comes and takes it out.
Well, it depends on the technology.
So and John, Dr. John is saying the gas stations, they put at gas station they put the device inside the pump. Does that mean that the person servicing the pump is putting the skimmer inside?
If so,
then here another thing that, hey, there is something else in here that's not supposed to be here. Kind of, I don't know. There's got to be a way to do more to protect the public. We have technology that could do it. I mean, even if there is a camera inside the pump.
You would think that banks would be on top of this in a big way, because they're the ones that are actually being impacted by this and losing money. But maybe it's an acceptable loss. Just like I won't say acceptable loss, but
it is.
It's an anticipated loss. It's a cost of doing business. So.
Yeah, maybe the losses are a lot less than what it would cost to have somebody ride around and check those things more often. It's possible.
Or maybe they're stealing the money.
Yeah.
What was the, do you remember that movie Office Space? Amnon, did you ever watch that movie Office Space?
Second favorite movie of all time.
Oh, what a great movie. But their scam was that they figured out a way to write a program that would capture all the fractions of a penny.
Oh, yeah.
So they thought, we'll make a couple hundred dollars a week. And they wound up making tens of thousands of dollars a week from all the transactions capturing that less than 1 cent. Yeah, that's a good movie.
I remember some years ago that there was a real situation like that.
Oh, no, it's based on plausible technology. Absolutely. That movie was 1999. Can you believe that?
All right, Spence, do you want to do specials?
I do. And if you'll bear with me for 1 second, I'll bring them up here.
Who's the bear?
I have two computers now. I've been using two since I don't want to overload my CPU here.
I've got a quick question while Spence is sorting that out.
Yeah.
For all the tech people in the chat and the people listening and indeed yourselves, good people. I want to convert or put an ISO onto a USB drive and make it bootable. Have any of you any experience with doing this?
I've done it with Windows 10 installer. They have part of their downloading of the ISO gives you the opportunity to create a bootable USB drive. Right. There's several places you can go that have tutorials on how to do it.
Because I've looked and there's loads of different programs that say they'll do it, but they only seem to do part of it. They don't actually put the ISO on and then make it bootable. Because I've done it for one, excuse me, I can't remember for the life of me how I did it, but it made the USB thumb drive bootable, which is great. But there's a new version of it now, and I'd like to do it on this computer rather than on the laptop. And I've tried three times with three different programs and none of them make it bootable. All the files are there, but it just won't boot.
Yeah, I just don't have enough experience creating a custom drive. I've done it with something that's a canned, already built procedure that you just follow where the person's written all the files and has it ready to go and you just do it. So,
Yeah, I've done a few of those myself, but to actually do it and convert the ISO to bootable USB, it seems like you've got to jump through two or three hoops to actually get the finished product. Quite complicated. I just wondered if somebody knew of a program that does it all in one. No, not to worry. Thank you anyway.
Amnon, you should get on this and come up with a solution. You have about 20 minutes.
Yeah. All right.
Well, you have until the end of me doing the specials to come up with a solution. How's that?
That's fine. I'll think about it while you're doing the specials.
All right. Well, we have Computers 2K Now specials for May 22nd, 2016, starting with staples. If you're in the market for an i7 laptop, this is a heck of a deal. It's a Core i7 15.6-inch Toshiba, $599.99. Regular price is $849.99, $250 off. This is the deal of the day on LED monitors. It's a Samsung 22-inch LED monitor for $99. Save $30. Logitech K400 wireless keyboard touch. Wireless touch keyboard. This is a wireless keyboard that's ideally suited for multimedia where you've got, you're sitting on the couch or something, you want to access the computer that's being used in your media center setup. It's got a built-in glide pad, $24.99, that's 15 off. That's probably the best price I've seen in a while on that product. Entry-level machine, desktop. This is an HP Slim Desktop i3 for $299.99, that's 150 off. New Samsung laser printer, automatic duplex and wireless, half price, $79.99. That's 80 off the regular price. If you're in the market for a portable printer, some people need this for work, real estate agents, whatever, people that who cut invoices or need to print things off as they travel around. Epson Workforce WF100 Inkjet Wireless Mobile Printer. It's one-third off. It's $199.99. That's 100 off the regular price. And HP OfficeJet Pro, $68.30. This is almost half off. It's $99.99, $80 off the regular price. 240 gig PNY SSD, solid state drive, for $69.99. And finally, the good old
Sam. That's a good deal.
That is a good deal. I mean, you don't have to use it for all your storage. Yeah, just use it for your to boot the operating system and your frequently used files. But good deal. Technology there has really caught up from a price perspective, which is great. Western Digital Ultra Portable 1 terabyte USB backup drive, $59.99. That's 20 off. I talk about this every week. I talk about backups. I mean, the price is just so good that you need to be doing this if you're not doing it already. That's at Staples. At Best Buy, we've got, Amnon, this is for you. I kind of highlighted some of their really expensive stuff. Here's an MSI 15.6-inch iCore i7 laptop. It's only $1,400. Come on. You buy at least one. That's a heck of a machine. Whited keyboard. I guess it's a gaming machine, considered a gaming machine. Wow. The Logitech 960. This is their latest pro webcam. $99.99, save $30. I read the reviews on this. The reviews across the board are very positive. I mean, there's always something about these products, especially when they're new, something to do with drivers and compatibility. But for the most part, well done. It actually comes with a built-in lens cover, which is nice. So you can just flip that lens cover down and when you're not using it. Inexpensive tablet, $40 for a 7-inch Android tablet with 8 gig of memory. Digiland is the brand. They've got an Insignia 10.1-inch 32 gig tablet for $99, save 20. 25-inch HP monitor for $149.99, save $80.
It's an unusual size, 25-inch.
Yeah, 25 IPS LED. Mm. Nice. SanDisk 32-gig USB 3.0 flash drive for $9.99, 25 off the regular price. The prices of these backup drives just keep coming down, especially the larger format drives. 5 terabyte USB 3.0 desktop backup drive for $139.99, save $60. You might as well just buy the thing and take the drive out and put it in your computer.
It's probably cheaper than buying a 5 terabyte drive.
Yeah, so it's amazing. Another good deal. I think this is the same solid state drive. Is that true? Was that both? Yeah, it's the same one, except it's cheaper. $240. It's $10 cheaper than at Staples. If it is, in fact, the same model. Yeah, it is the same model. 240 gig solid state drive PNY, $59.99, save $20. And that's a deal. 1 terabyte internal drive, $59.99. This is the Seagate everyday use model. I just bought one of these, got it even cheaper at Office Depot this past week. It was $5 cheaper than Best Buy. Brother inkjet printer, all-in-one. It's the 485 with duplex and wireless, $59.99, 40 off. The good old Brother laser printer. This is the one that's has duplex and wireless, $99.99, save $30. Probably more of these out there than any other printer from Brother. Samsung 28-inch 4K UHD LED monitor for $399.99, save $100. I mean, if you have the requirement for this type of a monitor, that's a really good deal. But alas, I would never buy one. Just too much money. That's all at Best Buy. And finally, Office Depot got some deals here. An entry-level laptop from Dell for $249.99, $130 off. Got a dual-core Pentium in it. a Lenovo entry-level AMD E1 dual-core for $189.99, save $110. It's a 23-inch LED monitor from Acer for $89.99, $80 off. It's a good deal. 4 terabyte Western Digital backup drive. It says Mac. They also have the equivalent one for PCs for a similar price. I would imagine that the Mac one, you could just reformat the drive and it would work. I mean, I don't see what, unless it just comes with Mac specific tools on it, whatever. But $109 for a 4 terabyte backup drive, regularly $169. This is an interesting device. TP-Link, I'm sorry, go ahead. Somebody saying something?
No, I was going to say the Mac, maybe the Mac uses a different connector.
No, it's a USB.
Okay.
USB 3.0. It's not Thunderbolt.
Oh, yeah, it says that. Never mind. Yeah. Go ahead.
TP-Link wireless AC 750 power line kit. I went and looked at this because I said, well, I want to understand what exactly this thing does. It's an interesting way. If you have a problem in your house with wireless and you don't want to go around adding access points around the house or adding wireless routers as access points, you can have this. This supports more than one connection. You get the base unit, which is the one you see with the
big one. Actually,
the small, the base unit is the one with this, the two Ethernet ports on it and the pass through for the AC power. The remote unit actually has dual band AC 750 wireless access point built in as well as Ethernet. But you can put these, you can have one base unit and have multiple remotes throughout your house, provided the wiring supports it. So you can say, I have my, you can just connect this to your, you have to have a router somewhere. I mean, you're not going to, and if you have the wireless router that comes built in, like the Aris built-in cable modem units that you rent from the cable company, you could take the Ethernet out of that, plug it into this, and distribute wireless throughout the house. So this particular unit, I think, is 500 meg capable, theoretical maximum speed across. I have a TP-Link I upgraded to that was a 500 meg unit, and I get my full wire speed that I can get through the cable modem down at my television in the family room across the power line in my house. And I'm going into an AC router and I'm getting a full 60 meg download speeds over wireless. And my total speed on my network is 60 coming in from the cable modem. So these devices work well, but you have to pay attention to where you place them in the house. Every outlet is not going to work well with every other outlet. That's just the nature of the way your house is wired.
Actually, it will not work at all if it's not on the same leg of the AC.
That's true. Unless you have a bridge that bridges that signal between the two. I have the X10 bridge in my system, but that doesn't bridge these signals.
Yeah. I read somewhere that they don't work in an extension strip. So if you've got a strip of 4 sockets, they don't always work in those very well.
Actually, I do have them in a strip.
It depends on whether they're surge protector or not. If they're just a power strip, it'll work.
Yeah, well,
if they're a surge protector strip, it may not.
And when you said AC, you mean alternating current or AC, the bandwidth?
No, yeah. The AC, the alternate. You see, here in the States, to get 220, you have two 110 legs. And when you combine them, as one is the left, one is the right, and then a ground, you get 220 or 240. In Europe, it's 220 by default.
Yes.
And I never played with it in Israel, but I don't know. Do you have three lines coming from the power line, power company, or two?
Just one for the UK for 220 volts.
Yeah. So, well, two, ground and one. Yeah. So in your case, it'll work anywhere.
Yeah. It doesn't matter. What happens is you have your circuit breaker panel, and those two legs come in, and one goes down the right side and one goes down the left side inside the bus inside this panel. So whatever breaker you're, whatever side you're connected to, you have to use that same side.
Right.
Yeah. All the breakers have to be associated with each other that way, logically inside. But
I did buy a pair of them, but I haven't actually got around to using them yet. I've just got a long cable coming from the other room. But
yeah, it works great. I've got two of them.
Hmm. Any of them coming out with AC bandwidth yet? You know, the new
that's,
standard.
That's what this is.
Yeah, this is a wireless AC. So it does support 5 gigahertz and 2.4 gigahertz at, and this one is a 750. It's not the full speed that AC gets.
Right. Oh, that's what I was querying. Okay, thanks. Yeah. I didn't realize they were available. I know that the old N speed was available, but I didn't realize AC was available.
But with this, you can also, not only does it do wireless, it also gives you Ethernet on the other side.
Yeah.
So you can plug, if you have a television, it's always better to wire it, go directly in with wiring. I have this going into a small switch, which then goes into my Apple TV, the television, the Blu-ray player, mm-hmm. and a computer I have downstairs. So I'm wired. Plus it has a access point, or it's a cable, a wireless router that's acting as an access point that is not actually...
The only thing I can't figure out with this, you're supposed to, like you said, you can have multiple ones. I have the base unit here because this outlet was the right one for the restaurant. And then there is one of them in the living room and one of them in the middle bedroom. So it feeds the bedroom too. And you're supposed to have it in a way you can configure it so it's the same network, which it is, but as you walk throughout the house, it changes. I couldn't figure out how to do that. So if Kathy wants to lay in bed and use her tablet, she needs to go to the tablet and choose TP1 instead of TP2. But they work great.
Yeah, they do. Yeah. All right. I had an older version of it that I recently replaced, and the newer ones are they work very well. So happy with it.
Nathan's asking, do you need additional wireless router on the access point that obtains internet from the base unit?
Say again?
Nathan's asking, do you need an additional wireless router on the access point that obtains internet from the base unit? Okay. I've got a pair, but I bought them and thought, well, that's a good price. I'll buy those, and I just haven't used them yet. I'll report back when I have.
Yeah,
what was the price on those, Spence, please?
$80 US.
Well, that's cheap for an AC one.
Yep. That is good. Mm. The simple ones that are just one or two port Ethernet with no wireless are down in the $30, $40 range. And finally, the last product we had here on the Office Depot Office Max is Epson Workforce WF7620. This is a high-end office-based inkjet printer scanner, fax copier. It's $199.99, $100 off, plus an additional $50 off if you trade in an acceptable printer. So we're looking at essentially half price. And that's it for the specials for today.
Well, thank you very much, Spence.
And I'm going to do next week's specials now too. Is that okay?
Looking into the future.
I'm gonna get out my time machine.
Sure.
Extra.
919-518-9773. Computers 2K voice on Skype. Let's see what else we have here. Now, Google. In Google Groups, let me switch. In Google Groups thread named Intent to Implement HTML5 by default, the Google developers announced initial plans to implement a new feature in the Chromium core that will disable the playback of Flash content by default and use HTML5 instead, if available. The feature is scheduled to ship with Chromium builds in the fourth quarter of 2016, according to the current timeline. To avoid over-prompting, a whitelist will allow 10 major websites to continue to show Flash content by default without pestering users with allow domain.com to run Flash Player. It seems like the so far the only two CDNs, the platforms that we use here that you see under the video, the channel 1, channel 2, channel 3, the only ones that I know that uses HTML5 will be channel 2, which is Daily Motion, and channel 3, which is stream.me. The other one, and of course YouTube, the other ones are still all using Flash, and I don't understand why they're not switching except for licensing and having to pay more money. There's really no, there's no difference in the playing. And if, Gene, I don't have any pick of the week. And Nick is not here. But if you wanna see what HTML5 works like right now, if you're on ConnectCast, which is the default, it's Flash.
And I have a pick of the week.
You want to do a pick of the week?
Yeah, it's interesting.
Sure,
how
tell us
what I have on my desk is the stuff that I've been using this past week, and this has come in handy again. I probably mentioned this over a year ago. And I apologize. It's in the package upside down. Oh, it's not going to show up too good. There we go.
Yeah.
This is one version of a ATX power diagnostic device that you can use if you're having a problem with your computer booting up. And Amnon, we were dealing with this past week, where my machine hadn't used in a while was not starting up. First thing I want to do is check out, is my power supply any good? So you take this device. You plug it in, it's not going to show up.
Right. It will if you put, fine.
But it's got ATX
connector
on it. It's got the 12-volt Pentium connection, mm-hmm. advanced power. It's got a Molex connector. It's got a, it's quaint. It's got the power for a floppy drive as well as SATA power, all mm-hmm. built in. And you plug it in and it will have the LEDs will light and tell you if your power supply. It actually provides the start signal, the soft start signal to the power supply. So it will in fact power the power supply up. You don't have to go in and try to jump something to get it to start.
So you
very handy.
You checked yours?
Oh yeah, I checked it. Remember, I came over. It was the same thing.
Did you check the one in that machine?
Yeah, and it showed that it didn't have any -5 volts, but some of them don't say that they supply -5 volts. They have to have -12, +5 and +12, but for some reason they don't all have -5.
-5 is ground.
Yeah. So this didn't show -5 in this case.
Did you try another computer, another power supply?
Yeah. Oh, no, and I pulled out all the spare power supplies I have and I plugged them all in.
None of them showed the -5.
No, some showed it and some didn't. And I looked at the labels, and the ones that showed it said they supplied -5, and the other ones that did not say -5 didn't show it. So I didn't realize it was optional.
Hmm. I thought that it has to have it because LEDs work on 5. I thought. Mike, what's the 5-volt for?
5-volt operates the entire motherboard. Yep. 12 volt is for things like the hard drives.
Hard drives, motors, and
Yep.
Interesting.
But I had I fired up my triple core machine, which I haven't used in a while, and it doesn't even beep. The fan will start to spin, the power supply comes up, but that's as far as it goes. So I stuck that on there, and I didn't have a very modern spare power supply laying around. So I dragged it over to Amnon's and plugged it into a brand new one. I got the same results. So I know the board is bad.
Okay. But before you trash it, well,
I looked at the caps. I looked at all the caps. There were no swollen caps that I could see.
Yeah, that doesn't mean that's not the case.
But I'm going to need to upgrade anyway. This is an old AM2 processor, triple core. That I just wanted to experiment. I wanted to load Windows 10, clean load, and then try running XSplit and Hangout and see what kind of processor impact it had. So if it was something that ran good, then I would just dedicate that machine just to doing video with
and else. Talking about Windows 10, guys, I had a call from Marshall this week. I think it was Tuesday morning, panicking that one of the girls did not turn off her machine. The evening before when she left to go home, and when she came up, she came in the morning, says, "Welcome to Windows 10."
Uh-oh.
Happened to two friends of mine.
Still happening.
And he says, "How do I roll back?" I said, "I never had to do it. Let's check and see." And really, I mean, it was at the point, I mean, I told him the instructions, but he said that on the screen, he had to click on accept and stuff like that.
Decline would roll back.
Right. And he declined and it rolled it back. So that's good to know.
That happened to two of my friends this past week.
Yeah.
It aggravates me so much that if Apple made a decent computer that would work, I would buy one.
All Apples all work. Macs just work.
Nothing is optional anymore.
No, I mean, they don't make a desktop computer, and that's what I use.
Do you remember we were talking about updating?
Hmm.
So, where was it? It's nice. Now they did that, sort of. Microsoft has released a convenience roll-up update for Windows 7 computers. The update to the nearly 7-year-old operating system brings with it a number of security fixes and patches that Microsoft labels as recommended. ZDNet is reporting this. The convenience rollup, officially known as Windows 7 SP1 Convenience Rollup, isn't Service Pack 2 for Windows 7, but it's the next best thing. The new Windows 7 Convenience Rollup is cumulative back to Service Pack 1, which Microsoft released in 2011. It consists of all security and non-security fixes all through April 2016. It doesn't include update to IE11, which are released separately, or updates to .NET releases. But it does include core Windows fixes, security fixes, and hot fixes. Microsoft says the convenience rollup package is completely optional. Install this one, update, and then you only need to update released after April 2016. Now, I went to download it, and the first thing I saw is that it requires you to install and run a program before that. And that's when I stopped. I decided to wait and read about it in maybe a few weeks, because they could do, you know, they're not known for being straightforward with us. So there could be something that program that they are running before that will do something to make it easier for them to get in with Windows 10. And that's what I didn't want. So I don't know, but if anybody wants to read about it, it's called the Windows 7 Convenience Rollup.
Okay, I just tried to go to the page to get it.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, "Thank you for visiting the Microsoft Update Catalog. To use this website's full functionality, you must be running Microsoft Internet Explorer 6.0 or later."
Right, and there were two links on that.
Guess what? I'm running later.
Oh, and it. Oh, but does it not allow you? Is this because I saw that and I was in Vivaldi, so I didn't even try. Did you try?
No, but it has two links here. It says to upgrade to the latest version of the browser, go to this website.
Yeah, and?
If you prefer to use a different browser, you can get updates from the Microsoft Download Center.
So they're not allowing you to download the roll-up.
And I click on that link and it said, you've got our latest browser.
God, what Thanks a bunch for of telling morons. Me something I already know. I read some comments on the bottom of that article, Amnon, and some people were saying it's about time that they made it available. They could have made it a lot easier. Why didn't they just call it Service Pack 2? But some
well,
people
it's
were
not.
Saying that when they install an older version of Windows 7, and then they have to, you know, select all these 48 updates or whatever it is.
48, 200 spent, and some.
Yeah. But some people just spent 8 hours
yeah.
getting the thing. You know, right. It's a whole day's work just yep. to update the machine.
Yep.
Why didn't they just call it Service Pack 2? It would have made life so much simpler.
I don't know.
Stupid people.
I don't know. It's
got to jump through hoops to get it as well.
Yeah, I'm just worried that there's something in it that gives them access, more access than what I would want to give
yeah,
an update.
You can guarantee the KB3035583 will be checked and it will yeah. be one of the downloads sure. you have to get.
Yeah, but I mean, this is not for a system that's already up to date. This is when you install Windows 7, because they still sell Windows 7.
Yeah,
so when you install it, instead of sitting there for, like you said, eight hours on my foot, it took on one machine, it took over 2 days.
Wow.
So yeah, that will be great because you put it in and go.
Yeah, download it and burn it to a disk.
Yep.
All right, so I'm going through the process of downloading it. And I installed that little utility because it's only installing it in IE, I guess, which I don't use. But so it's now brought me up to I click on it and it brings up another window. I am to add it to the basket. Now I have the update for Windows 7 64-bit based on KB3125574, and it's now added to the basket. And then up in the corner, there is a view basket. I click on that. There's one there. Then I click on the download button, and it's asking me where I want to download it. And I've got to find a place to put it, and we'll see how it goes. We'll put it on the backup drive.
Yeah, I will need to download the 64 and the 32. A lot of people lately are asking to reinstall, to restore to factory. And they don't want to do it themselves, so they bring the computer over. I don't know why. And it's a good thing that they have the license on the machine.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up because that was actually my pick of the day. I've had a week from hell. I have some friends who run a small business who I've been doing their computer work for 10 or 15 years. I've tried on multiple occasions to get out of doing it. By the way, it just finished downloading.
Oh, so it's not that big.
That's 500 megabytes.
Okay, yeah, keep going.
So they decided it was time for new computers. They're getting ready to get into their busy system. So I bought four new Lenovo i7, i5 quad-core computers. Seemed to be really good deals, 8 gig of RAM. And their setup is really not very complicated. But what happened was one of the periods of time that I tried to get out of doing their work, they actually had a guy doing it who was one of the typical IT guys, which that's not said lovingly. And whenever he set them up on Windows 7, he set them up on 32-bit Windows Home, Windows 7 Home Edition.
For office use.
For office use.
Okay.
So, I was already on 64-bit whenever he set them up on 32-bit. And they were brand new Dell computers, no problem. There's no reason he should have done that. Well, he also set them up using Microsoft Outlook 2010, which they had at the time, using IMAP. Now, the problem with that is that Outlook, even to this day, does not understand IMAP well. It does not work well. It works. It does not work well.
Mm-hmm.
And starting with Outlook 2010, every time you add an email account, it creates a new PST file that creates a new archive folder in the left column. And bottom line is that this whole situation was so messed up, it was unbelievable. Well, what I learned the hard way is that if in their situation, they had actually it was three, but I'll simplify it to two. They actually had two PST files on each computer. One was outlook.pst created by Outlook. The other is email.pst for their email account. Well, okay, that doesn't seem like a problem. Back in the old days, it was Outlook PST. Everything was in one. Starting right. with 2010, they start breaking it down into different PST files. I do some experimentation and find out that some of their email is in the email.pst file, and a lot of other stuff's in the Outlook.pst file.
Okay.
Well, that sounds simple, but it's not. I've spent 3 hours figuring out a solution to this. Ultimately, what I had to do when I moved them over is I renamed Outlook.pst to email.pst. When I set up, before opening Outlook, when I set up their email accounts, I told it to use their email.pst as their folder and as the default. That Yep. meant they had all of their contacts and everything else in there. Then what I did was I opened their email.pst account as an open, just as an open file, not as part of the integration, whatever the correct explanation is, and dragged all of their email out of that into the default PST file. So they only now have one PST file, which is the way it should have been all along for one email account. All that went well. I was very happy with that. But what I wanted to back up and tell you is that my pick of the day, and you guys have probably heard of it, is a program called BellArc, mm-hmm. BellArc. It's at BellArc.html. BellArc.com. I'm sorry, I'm distracted. BellArc.com. And what this program does is it goes through and it profiles your hard drive, your operating system. It tells you what programs are. It tells you your network access. It does a security check to see if you are missing some security updates. It does a lot. It's been around a long time. It's a really good one. Having said that, one benefit that it had was that these guys didn't want to spend money if they didn't have to. I checked and saw that Outlook 2010 and Office 2010 are still Windows 10 compatible. The computers are Windows 10. Mm-hmm. Let's make sure you've got the install disk for each of these four computers. No, we don't have any install disk. You don't have the Office. Nope. Okay. Well, that's a problem. What I ultimately found out is that I did a search and found out that there is a website operated by Microsoft that it says you want to download down level versions of Outlook 2010, Office 2010, 2007. They're there. You go in and put in your key and your product key, and not only will it tell you which version the key is for, but it'll also then give you a link to download the installation disk for that version.
From BellArc?
No, from Microsoft.
From Microsoft. Oh, yeah.
And so what I then on the disadvantage is you got to do it that the file is customized for that product key. So I had to do it four times.
But it's got all the correct drivers.
No. Oh. This is for Office. I'm talking about Office now.
So why does it care what? Okay, go keep going.
Well, they just don't want anybody downloading it and burning up their servers for whatever reason. You have to prove that you have a license to it, a valid license. Then it gives you a link to download the EXE, the installable EXE for that program.
Right.
So what I did was I got the product key out of BellArc. Pasted it into this Microsoft website, and it gave me a link to download Office and Outlook, which are two separate downloads for each of those computers. Yeah, I mean, it just shocked me that Microsoft would still allow you to download Office 2010.
Well, this is something that a lot of people are not doing. They don't think about it, and I wish more people did that. When you buy a new computer and it has the sticker on it with the key, take a picture of it right away. I mean, a good picture, close up, that you can read. Because these things get rubbed out, they dry out. When you need it, you're not going to be able to figure out what it is.
I just posted one link into chat.
Yeah.
That I guess I'm on the right site. Now that, yeah, it's from Microsoft.com. So what happens is you put the key that you have in there, and there's another one for Outlook. I mean, I just did a deep link search, but this is the site that I used. You put the product key in there, select the language, type in this garbage on the right, and it takes you to a link that allows you to download it. Now, here's what I would suggest. If you're using a version, an older version of Office, and you don't know where your disks are, or you want a different, the file installed file, install BellArc today, search through it, and find your license key for your Microsoft Office and or Outlook product. Go to this website or search for the one that's above it. I forget where it is above it. And go ahead and download it and just put it away and save your key in a text file in the same folder.
Right.
I was very pleased with it. So BellArc is my pick of the day. I've used it for years. If you don't know about it, you should know about it, because it really does. It does work well.
Anytime I work on a machine where I'm going to upgrade or change or tweak, I run BellArc and print it off and have it available. Moving people from one machine to another, it's critical that you take a good snapshot of what they're running, that you're not missing anything when you move them over.
Now, one thing I did notice about BellArc that I either missed it or I don't like it. There's no way to save a PDF or Word file that's properly formatted. You have to actually save the HTML file and then open it in the browser.
But at least there is a way to save these things.
Well, you can print it to PDF. I mean, there are other ways around it, but it just surprises me that it's not a button there that says save as PDF.
What I do is I use Snagit. And I just I do screen caps, and then I paste it into a Word document.
Okay, but that's graphic. That's not.
It's not scannable, and it's not. But it's just a way to save it. in a small format.
There's a free program called Cute PDF that allows you to print to PDF for free, and you can use that. That works really well.
Mike, you were talking about the guy putting a Windows 32-bit. I found out on many cases that if a machine has 4 gig of RAM, if you put the 64-bit Windows, it gets sluggish. And putting the 32, and it flies. So if you don't have a reason to do that, I mean, it's much better to just upgrade the memory and put more memory, so you know 8 or at least 6. But if you have a machine that has 4 gig on it only, and it's Windows 7 or 8 64 that is installed, if you put the 32-bit, it works much, much faster.
Yeah, well, that's the benefit of 64 is it allows you to go up to 8 gig of memory, which has many other benefits. So I understand what you're saying, but this guy, I mentioned him before on the show, this guy, when he put their computers in, by the time he was done putting them in, his labor for installing 4 computers was more than they paid for the computers.
Yep.
Yeah.
So I had my son do a lot of the work, because obviously I work during the week, but every night I've been working through issues, and there were a bunch of issues. There were a bunch of problems, so things that I had to reverse engineer and figure out the way this guy had done. But I took a lot of extra time, and I'm setting them up now so that it's like I told them. I said, if I got hit by a truck tomorrow, anybody who knows anything at all about simple Windows networking can walk in and look at what I've done and figure it out in about 3 minutes.
Now, there's the conundrum. There's no such thing as simple Windows networking.
If it's working fine and you've done home networking, you can figure it out.
Yeah.
I did have another interesting thing happen yesterday.
Let's hear.
It's totally unrelated to computers. If you want to hear it.
Sure.
Absolutely.
I sort of spooked my kids because I've started talking lately about what happens when I'm gone. I mean, I'm 62. I probably don't have another 30 years, but that being said, I mean, I've got a lot of things that to me have a lot of value that they have no value to anyone else. And I get that, but I also have a lot of things that are very valuable and very useful. I mean, a lot of my toys and tools are very expensive. I've got just as a case in point, I've got a pair of pliers that I bought. You know how on the back of a piece of electronic equipment, you know how they have this little, it's called a HACO connector. It's a little plastic strain relief that has a sort of a D cut out on it. It's a circle with flat sides, and you squeeze the little tab on it to pull the power cord in and out.
Right.
You can never familiar with those.
I'm not familiar with the pliers, but I'm familiar with the, yeah, every device has that. The wire is not just going in. It goes through. Yeah.
It's got a little, you know what it is, Spence? You know what I'm talking about?
Yes. Yep.
All right. Well, the pliers to use on those to take them in out, what we've always done for years is use either regular pliers or needle nose to squeeze the tab down so you can pull it out.
Mm-hmm.
That puts the pressure on the collar around it, and it actually damages the collar. It mutilates it. What?
It mutilates it.
Yes. So the way it works is, you've got this round piece and you've got pliers that come in, and actually a little thin part, they're steel, so they're durable. They go in and they push down behind the collar so that you can squeeze it and then pull it out. It doesn't mutilate it. I have a pair of pliers to do that with, and the pair of pliers alone is $55. Just to do that one little limited function. I have found no other way to do it. And back when I was working on electronic equipment for people, I didn't want to work on their equipment, send it back to them with pieces of it mutilated.
Mm-hmm.
Well, my comment, what I teased my kids, so look, when I'm gone, let me ask you, what would you do with this? Throw it in a trash can? I don't know what that is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So they throw it in a trash can. Well, I'm working on some projects for this studio that I built, some that I'm going to build for you, Amnon, maybe if you want it. And it involves using some little tiny modules I buy out of Hong Kong. They're really cheap, but they do what's called a monostable multivibrator, and that is that they're push on. It doesn't matter what it is, little, but they come with these little 4-pin headers on them, like it uses exactly the same connector that you used to use for a floppy drive. That mm-hmm. 4-pin connector that you plug into a floppy drive.
Right, on the back, yeah.
Those pins are what are called 2.5 millimeter spacing, those pins, that's a header. And that's what it uses to connect to the board, which is fine, which is stupid, but fine. But the back when I was in the manufacturing business, we used to use that same connector to connect to remote keypads. Well, the company that I worked for shut down when I did. They called me and said, if you want this equipment, come get it. I went over there, and whatever was left, I loaded into a box and brought it home, didn't bother with it. When I was trying to come up with a connector to mate with this board, it recurred to me that it was the same connector we used to use in the business, manufacturing business. And I thought I had a bunch of those connectors. I looked around, couldn't find any. I went online and looked and went to digikey.com, and I found them, 17 cents a piece. They still make them, of all things. It's actually a very common connector. And I said, wait a minute. I think I've got a tool to put those connectors on the wires. Went over to my toolbox, dug through it, and sure enough, I found out that I've got the exact tool that you use to put these connectors on the ends of these wires. And I mean, this is a very neat tool. you actually put the connector in here and you put a wire into a hole, you pull the trigger like that, it crimps the wire in there, advances the connector, you put the next one in. I mean, it's a really quick way of making them. We were doing them low volume manufacturing. And out of curiosity, I said, well, I wonder what, if I needed another one of these, what this would be worth.
Mm-hmm.
Well, turns out they still make it. Still a common product. And I looked it up. It's made by AMP, which is now TE, but it's made by AMP.
That's expensive.
And I looked up this part number in there and found out that this thing is $103. Well, I then looked at it again and noticed the picture. The picture was only for this part of it.
Oh, because it's, you can use it for different connectors.
You can put different ties in it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so then I started looking at this part of it, looked in there. Sure enough, they still make this head assembly as well. $180.
Jeez.
So my daughter was over here last night. I walked in there and I said, all right, so I'm gone. You're getting ready to clean up my mess. I said, you see this, what would you do? Throw this in the trash can? Probably. Don't know what it is. Okay. If you bought one new, it's $300. I'm not supposed to know that. And I said, at least take time to look the stuff up on on eBay. At least look up on Google and find out what it's worth, because some of this stuff's worth a lot of money. $300.
That's scary.
Never used it.
But you've got one if you should need to.
I've got it. And if you need to use it, I'll loan it to you. It really is a very neat little trick.
It's a bit like my dad. His workshop, he's got all manner of things out there that he was passed down from his dad and he managed to acquire over the years. I bet some of that's worth a fortune.
Yeah. Well, my daughter said, well, you need to start selling it now. I said, no, I might need it.
Hey, Mike, I've got this one that I don't know what I'm going to do with it.
What?
This one I was using for putting SCSI and IDE cables. And what you do is you open it and you put the thing in there and you lock it. And then it will ratchet in and push that 40 or 50 pin. I really don't know what I'm going to do with it. If you have a collection of specialty tools, you're welcome to it.
No.
I mean, this is probably about 5 pounds.
I know. I probably have one.
And you can change the dies. You can just take out the thing and put otherwise, but I don't have any other thing for it.
So anyway, it's been an interesting week of things that I've uncovered.
Yeah.
And that being said, anyway, I have to dig out of here shortly. Oh, by the way, I was going to tell you the other thing I was going to tell you. I knew there was something. Steve, I did get HFS working, HTTP file server.
Yeah.
I did get it working. And for anyone who wants to play with it, what I noticed was that I had to forward port 8080 to this computer.
Okay.
When I did, then it automatically pulled up the right IP address instead of my local IP address.
Okie doke. Good. Glad you got it sorted.
I was going to say, what am I supposed to do with that link?
What link?
The one that you sent.
Just click on it.
Well, not now. I mean, don't want something to...
It's not going to automatically download. It's going to give you an option to download.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, I don't want to open something that will suddenly cover some... other stuff.
Well, what I'm going to do, I'm going to post it in our chat, and it won't be good, but about another 15 minutes because I have to leave to go downtown. And so copy URL address. Let's see if this gives it to you. Yes. So if you want to see how HFS works, if you're in the Computers 2K Now chat, if you click on that link, it's going to open a a web page that has two links on it. They're just two test files there. If you want to download either one, that's fine. HFS.exe is the one that is
yeah, I opened it. I opened it here and I see it. I'm on this machine here that I'm the monitor. I can do it. It's fine. Yeah, I see that. Nate.
I had a, before we close off, I had a bit of a shock, stroke, surprise today. You know, my father is not into computing at all, and he tried one a few years ago and just said, no, I can't get on with it. I'm too frustrated. Well, he bought a Surface Pro 3 about 8-9 months ago. And he's got to the same point where he's totally frustrated with it and doesn't want it anymore. Nope. No matter what I say to him, he just doesn't want to know. So he sent me an email saying, that's it, I'm out of here. No longer, I've had enough. So I went straight around to see what he was talking about and why this, that, and the other. No convincing, whatever I said. Nope, I've made my mind up. He'd already boxed it up and it's stuck in a bag ready for me to bring home. There you go. I hope you enjoy it more than I did.
Wow.
Nice.
So I now have a Surface Pro 3 with keyboard.
You really ought to get him an iPad.
Well, he wouldn't accept it now. If we'd have got him an iPad instead of the Surface Pro 3, then possibly. But he wouldn't even entertain having a computer brought through the door, even if I snuck it in there.
Yeah. Well, his life will not be unlivable as a result of not being intruded upon by technology.
Right.
No, he says he's happy to let it go, that he won't have any frustrations anymore. So I haven't bought a tablet up to now because I thought that I probably won't ever need one or use one. But now that I've got one, as it were, because he gave it to me, I'll let you know my findings in the next few weeks.
It's a love-hate thing. A lot of people who have them love them and other people detest them. There doesn't seem to be a middle ground.
If it's,
I see a lot of seniors with iPads. Sorry.
I was going to say, there have been quite a few times where I thought, oh, I could have a look at that online. Oh, I can't be bothered to turn the computer on the monitor and get it all set up and then go into browser. Ah, can't be bothered. If I can just pick up a tablet and it's there ready to go in a matter of seconds, then, and while I'm still sitting in my easy chair, then maybe I will use it.
My wife gave me a Kindle, a Fire HD 8.9 a couple of years ago. And at the time I really wasn't thinking about tablets and that sort of thing. I wasn't that interested in it, but I will tell you that it has been very useful. It has been very there. I'm still not into reading books on it. I've read a couple of books on it. I'm still not into reading books on it, but when I need to take a book with me, or if I'm going to do some work on something and I need to take the user manual, it is really convenient.
Yeah, I guess I will be able to use it, and you know, I'll know. But it's like a lot of things, isn't it? You don't know how useful it is until you actually have one.
Yeah, you use it as a tool. You don't just, okay, I've got it. What can I do with it?
I have an original iPad first generation that can't be upgraded. I actually jailbroke it and found that really didn't make any difference either. But one thing I do use it for is manuals, PDF manuals. If I want to go out to the car, I've got the service manual for the 2002 Mazda in PDF format that I can just go out and use it, zoom in on the little pictures. It's great. It's not very useful otherwise. If there's an app out there that has older versions that are still supported, some of the new ones you download, it says, sorry, you have to have iOS whatever to use this. This is stuck at 5, but there are still weather apps and other things that I can use that are useful, but it's a shame that they had to build in that obsolescence. But,
well, that's Apple for you.
Yeah, Steve, I do have one other question you may not have looked at in this HFS. Is there any way that it would work with UPnP to randomize the port?
I don't think so. I think you can set a port, or it's 8080.
Right, but even if it's 8080, you have to go in and forward it. So, if, I mean, for security reasons, like 8080 will not be forwarded in 5 minutes. And there would be a way if you could do a UPnP that would more like temporarily open a port in the router for, say, an hour. That would really cut down on the ability to somebody to hack it, I would think.
I don't know because I never utilized any feature like that, so I didn't look for it. So I don't have an answer, sorry.
Mike, I thought Spence, you may know more, but I remember the rule was to go into your router and disable UPnP.
I always turn it off.
Yeah, security, if you don't need it, of course you turn it off. Need it.
And Wi-Fi protected access, WPA, turn that off too. That uses UPnP, but that's where you have a code that you can, one-time code that you can use to connect and turn that off too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, guys. It's that time again. That was fun. Anybody has anything else they want to mention? Last minute? All right. So let's wind it down. Thanks, Mike. Thanks, Spence. Thanks, Steve. Andrew, if you're still listening. And good morning, Kathy, Hannah, Nabil, Mac, Norm, Katie, and Donna. Thanks, everybody, for tuning to Computers 2K Now. We hope you enjoyed and maybe learned something from our time together. Remember to practice safe computing. Update your virus scanner. Back up your hard drive. We'll be back here next Sunday at 9, but you can always reach us at computers2know.com. While you're at it, like us on Facebook. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Today at 1 o'clock, it's the Gisela DiCarlo Show. No Tanya Love tonight. And tomorrow, 1 is Breaking Free and Triangle Be Well. See you, everybody.
You are tuned to the Nissan Communications Network. Our weekly lineup of call-in programs includes Computers 2K Now with Amnon Nissan, My Life, My Will with Gisela DiCarlo, The Tanya Love Show, Help Thin with Debbie Brooke, Breaking Free with Marilyn Shannon, Triangle Be Well with Howard Jacobson, Lunch and Learn with Rabbi Yisrael Cutler, Lessons of Vietnam with NCVVI members, Current Affairs with Amnon Nissan. And if you tuned in too late, you can always watch each program in its entirety or download an MP3 audio file of it in the archives section on NissanCommunications.com. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow us on Twitter, and like us on Facebook. Sponsored by Atomos.com, makers of quality video recorders and converters, CarolinaApparel.com, and DeltaForce.net.